Before we get started, thank you all for coming out this afternoon. Though the weather is finally warming up. My name is Susan Burns, and I'm the director of the Center for East Asian Studies, which is the sponsor for this wonderful series of talks. I'm delighted to see such a great turnout from so many different parts of the university here. Before I turn things over to my colleague, Professor Foxfeld, to introduce Dr. Tomii, our speaker today, I just want to mention a couple of upcoming events. Next Tuesday, Justin Jeske, one of our former students, will be doing the East Asia by the Book talk over at the Seminary Co-op Bookstore. That will be Tuesday, April 16th at 5 p.m. And the title of his book and his talk relates rather nicely to today's talk, called Art and Engagement in Early Postwar Japan. So I hope I will see some of you over there. And I also wanted to mention that we have two other talks in our CEAS lecture series coming up this month. They're kind of bunched together in the spring quarter. On the 25th, Ruth Podolsky, professor of Chinese history at Vanderbilt, will be talking about Qi of Heaven, Qi of the Void, Atmosphere, Air, and the Sacred in Late Qing, Translated Science. And that will be over in our usual room, Regenstein 122A, and it'll be at the usual time of 5 p.m. And then on April 29th, I don't know how to pronounce the first name, Ron Kwan of Korea University will be here talking about self-determination and representation in the March 1st movement, an exploration of simultaneity and immediacy in 1919 colonial Korea. And that will also be over in Regenstein 122A. So I hope you all will come to those talks as well. And now I'll ask Chelsea to introduce today's speaker.
Hello everyone, thank you for coming. Chelsea Foxel from the Art History Department. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Reiko Tomii as part of this CEAS lecture series tonight. Dr. Tomii is a New York-based art historian and curator, as many of you know, who's been energetically engaged in the study of post-1945 Japanese art, even before this subject was really represented in the art historical discipline in the US or Europe. Working to this end, Reiko founded Honja Genkon, the post-1945 Japanese art discussion group, together with Dr. Miwako Tezuka back in 2003. Since then, Honja Genkon has held 8 symposia developing different themes, inviting scholars from all over the world, with the most recent symposium held here in 2007 at the University of Chicago. Since then, it's possible to say that in the field of modern and contemporary Japanese art history, it's really come into its own with Reiko already by its side. And with her lucid articles, exhibitions, and now an award-winning book, Reiko is undeniably a force in the blossoming field of post-1945 Japanese art studies. Dr. Tomii is the author of many important articles, including 2 in Positions, and one of which is Historicizing Contemporary Art, Some Discursive Practices in Gendai Bijutsu in Japan. She's also written on Akasegawa Genpei as a populist avant-garde. She's been a curator in a number of exhibitions and exhibition catalogs, including Global Conceptualism at the Queen's Museum of Art, Art, Anti-Art, Non-Art at the Getty Research Institute in 2017, and Kazuo Shiraga, 6 Decades. Her latest book is Radicalism in the Wilderness, International Contemporaneity and 1960s Art in Japan, published by the MIT Press in 2016 and a recipient of the distinguished Robert Motherwell Book Award. This book is also now the foundation for a new exhibition that you can see right now in New York City at the Japan Society, also called Radicalism in the Wilderness, but with a different subheading about Japanese artists and the global 1960s. I haven't seen this exhibition yet, but I can at least address the successes of Dr. Tomii's book, Radicalism in the Wilderness. It's a sophisticated yet incredibly accessible book that draws on individual cases and recent scholarship, and it really develops a language intended, as she says, to reassess the center through the periphery by comparison, and, quote, to place analytical pressure on the center and on Eurocentrism from the direction of 1960s Japan. This book, through the title, you might think is geared toward very specialist audiences, but I really found that this book speaks to all of us that are working on Japan or on areas other than the Euro-American center. And she really lays the death blow to the once prevalent assumption that avant-gardes from other parts of the world were mere imitations of those in the West. And so she lays out this theory of connections and resonances to develop new ways of repositioning 1960s and 1970s Japanese art. Thank you for listening, and please welcome Dr. Reiko Tomii.
Thank you, Josie. You can hear me, right? Okay, good. And then I'm very happy to come back to Chicago. That was 2017. But anyway, so I cannot believe it's already 2 years since I came here last time. And then anyway, the as Chelsea mentioned, I am very happy to tell you that my book, Radicalism in the Wilderness, was funding for an exhibition with a different subtitle and opened at Japan Society Gallery in New York already earlier in May.
In March.
Yeah, sorry, we are all mixing up the chronology. So they created a very nifty, you know, teaser they call TAD, which you can pick up at the outside the door. So the please take one, and then don't forget to visit New York. It's until June 9th, so maybe you can come after you finish all your postwork or grading or something like that. Exhibition and a book have a different feels. And the exhibition will be on view until June 9th, so, you know, I'm showing some of the installations show. Today, I would like to focus on the book and its theoretical and methodological implications. In the book, I have presented two basic concepts, wilderness and contemporaneity, as key methodological frameworks, and I hope I have proposed to construct a world art history of modernism in plural by constructing local and global art histories and merging them through a comparative methodology. These two words correspond to two types of strategy in art history. Wilderness is an artist strategy, while contemporaneity is an art historian strategy. In a sense, I put two books in a single volume. The first book is rather self-explanatory. It's about the wilderness, presenting three hitherto lesser-known artists and their works. The book offers an in-depth look into their phenomenal practices. Matsuzawa Yutaka, a pioneer conceptualist, made a complete break from the materiality of art in 1964 and decided to mobilize the mental faculty of kannen, meditative visualization, in the viewer as the foundation of his immaterial art. Through this art of kannen, he invented non-sensory painting that exists invisibly. In theory, you should be able to see it if you properly deploy your kannen. In practice, that's not so easy. So in 1967, Matsuzawa invented a step-by-step exercise so that you can see a white circle with your mind's eye. From here, using the instruction of kannen, he undertook a series of exhibition projects that are completely immaterial or invisible or weird. And then he proposed banishing of humankind all for the service of anti-civilization that would replace the materialist civilization that had brought humanity to the brink of extinction. Founded in 67, the play, a unique collective of happeners, made a series of happenings, or what they call voyages, into landscape, to rivers, mountains, an ocean, and an island, in order to question the complacency of our everyday consciousness. Also founded in 67, GAN, short for Group Ultra Niigata, produced a significant body of work through land art, mail art, and critical art. Their 1970 performance of Event to Change the Image of Snow is a daring yet ephemeral work that existed only for 13 minutes in the continually falling snow. Among the works of individual members created under the collective banner of Kan, Horikawa Michio's mail art by sending stones demonstrates an inventive and imaginative nature of these three practitioners. I characterize these manifestations of inventiveness and imagination as wilderness. As you can see from these examples you just saw, wilderness is remote landscape. But in this book, wilderness is more than no man's land. It has several layers of meaning with a connotation of out there. Above all, these practitioners work out there geographically. Matsuzawa lived in Shimotsuo in central Japan, number 15 here. Gan, as its name demonstrates, hailed from Niigata on the backside of Japan, facing the Japan Sea, here 10 and 17. In this, and then Prey was a group based in Osaka, 12 and 9, and you know, the Kansai Kinki area. In this sense, the activities in the wilderness signifies regionalism. The expressions are also out there, or outside the norm in thinking in art or everyday life. Matsuzawa's immaterialism, the praise voices into landscape, or Gan's snow painting, embody their thinking that is out there. Their out there status also put them outside the metropolitan culture of the avant-garde, such as Pilot Center and Monoha. And more importantly, their location outside the mainstreaming state of contemporary art, mainly in here, like presented by Monoha and the Expo Art. It is important to understand what happened after January 64, when the Yomiuri newspaper company terminated the Yomiuri Independent Exhibition, which had served as the almost only institutional site for the anti-art avant-garde. During the post-Yomiuri years, contrary to the vanguard artist's sense of loss, contemporary art gained a considerable presence in the mainstream art world and became a force to reckon with. In the spirit and in their expression, our three wilderness practitioners were outside this mainstream in contemporary art, bringing in another layer of meaning, wilderness as out of the seat of power. This is a historical layer of wilderness, or koya in Japanese, where in ya, in koya stands for being outside of seat of power, either by circumstance or by choice. In the traditional East Asian vocabulary, in China, politicians descend to the wilderness when they lose their positions in the court and the government. Literary painting was part of this tradition when scholar painters withdrawing from the seat of power to critique the officially sanctioned academic painting. In modern Japan, being in the wilderness, zaya, gained a positive connotation of not participating in the institutional system, whether the government, corporation, the art world, or academia. That is to say, wilderness in the East Asian tradition signifies an alternative to the mainstream and the establishment. And our three protagonists offer alternatives to a mainstreaming contemporary art represented by Kutai Monoha and then Expoart. This spirit of ya and all the implications of wilderness is best exemplified by Matsuzawa's 64, Independent 64 in the Wilderness, from which I initially borrowed the idea of wilderness. What we have here is the use of desolate landscape away from Tokyo, the application of such out there ideas as immaterial exhibition and then communication method that may improve empathy. He's upholding the idea of independent exhibition as a free forum, and his embrace of do-it-yourself tradition of Japanese modernism in rejection of the authority and institution. This, in a nutshell, is wilderness as an artist strategy I highlighted in my book. Seeing these examples of their works, you may have already thought of parallel or similar works produced by their Euro-American counterparts, which include Eve Klein's Immateriality and the Void, Alan Kaplow's Happening, and Robert Smithson's Langa Art, among many others. It is my contention that, on the one hand, a straight-out history is an indispensable method in narrating local stories of these three practitioners or any other artist. On the other hand, we still have to find a way to talk about them in a broader global context and how to build a world art history of modernism based on these key artists and key works. This is a theoretical methodological challenge I took on in this volume, and it concerns contemporaneity as a method for art history. For the rest of my time, I would like to outline contemporaneity as a method using a concrete example of works that involve stones. To do so, we will go back in time about 10 years to the fall of 2008. The place was the Sainsbury Center for Visual Art in Norwich in United Kingdom, which presented On Location, Art, Space and Place in the 60s, an exhibition to study practices sited outside gallery walls. The accompanying publication pointed to a larger project of what art history in its subtitle, citing Robert Smithson and his contemporaries. Among the artists included in the show was Horikawa Michio, represented by two stones he mailed from Niigata, Japan to London in 2000 and 2001 to reprise mail art by sending stones, his signature project from 69 to 72. Unfortunately, his solitary non-Western presence in the otherwise Euro-American mix failed to trigger an expansive study on a rich roster of stone-based practices in 60s Japan, ranging from Monoha stones to conceptualist stone, or for that matter, phenomenal land art of his group Gan, or radically dematerialized state of art in 60s Japan as a whole. Back then, in 2009, when the artist told me about the exhibition, I thought it was a missed opportunity, though perhaps unavoidable. A general lack of local knowledge was one hindrance, certainly. More excruciatingly, however, we were so used to seeing things from our familiar Eurocentric narrative or modernism that even a token representation failed progress. One stone at a time, we might have said. But addition has proven to be an inadequate methodology in and of itself, unless we want to produce encyclopedic knowledge, which would narrate no history. Without an active examination, books from Japan or any other non-Western locales, like Horikawa's stones, might indefinitely remain exotic specimens in a global wunderkammer. The situation has certainly been greatly improved, and we see more works of non-Western origins in our museums and art history courses today. However, we still need a methodology to see the local in a broader context of the global. In order for localized addition to become effective, it must be amplified, namely expanded by local knowledge and meaning leading to the global. At the same time, decentering alone is not entirely adequate. It has encouraged articulating multiple modernisms, which will still remain unconnected without concerted efforts to linking them among themselves and to the global. In other words, regrouping them is indispensable to constructing a world art history, just as recentering has frequently been conceptualized from the periphery. Regrouping will ultimately have to also be undertaken from the periphery, not just from the center alone. Using Horikawa's stones, a key work of Japanese conceptualism, as a point of departure, I will outline a bottom-up and periphery in methodology that I have proposed in my book. It is kind of manual demonstration for world art history in which we will explore how to decenter, amplify, and regroup post-war art. The foundational concept of my methodology is international contemporaneity, kokusaiteki dōjisei, which was discussed in Japan during the 60s, a pivotal time in the history of modernism. It was the decade when Japan, long situated at the margin of modernism, was briskly catching up with and sometimes outpacing its Euro-American counterparts. In this, Japan was in good company with other areas in the periphery, such as Latin America and East Central Europe, outliving the modernist curse of belatedness and achieving contemporaneity and global relevance in the 60s. In this broader framework, Japanese practitioners negotiated a treacherous turn of contemporaneity, both in practice and in theory. Treacherous, because even though modernism certainly entered a new phase, which the Japanese embraced by calling the avant-garde Gendai Bijutsu or literally contemporary art, neither the perception or even reality of center-periphery hegemony ever disappeared. What I call the imitation discourse, for example, was among several discursive episodes that amply demonstrate the conundrum of contemporaneity in 60s Japan. These circumstances make 60s Japan a paradigmatic site to examine in world art history, where in the national and transnational, the local and the global are inextricably entwined. Derived from the Japanese discourse of international contemporaneity, the notion of contemporaneity in Japanese is dōjisei or dōjidaisei, meaning that two things are happening at the same time or era. This definition diverges from contemporaneity associated with a contemporary used in the current global discourse on contemporary art, when contemporary, which means of the time, of this time, has opened a theoretical horizon to explore the temporal dimension in art practices, like Terry Smith has been doing. What makes the discourse of 60s Japan significant is that its construction of Gendai Bijutsu not only articulated the sense of contemporaneity as dōjisei, but defined post-war art after gestural abstraction as distinct phase of contemporary Gendai, as opposed to modern Kindai, making 60s Japan a precursor of today's contemporary art. In my methodological proposal, contemporaneity serves as a tool to apply analytical pressure from the periphery on the Eurocentric narrative of modernism in general and post-war art in particular. Since contemporaneity manifests itself through similarities, a methodological foundation is comparison. Specifically, our comparison is intended to seek out similar yet dissimilar characteristics among a set of similar works, thereby going beyond surface similarities and expanding our local knowledge. Similarity can be strategic or conceptual, like the practices cited outside the gallery as with the premise of the knowledge exhibition, or it can be more elementary, like using such nomad material as stones. Let us start with the most elementary stones in the spirit of bottoms up. Two canonical works studied in the Norwich project, Smithson's Nonsai and Horikawa's Mela by Sending Stones, can be supplemented by Horikawa's Japanese contemporaries for added depth and scope for examination. Possible additions are Takamatsujiro's stone and numeral from 69, Kashiwahara's stone's rock from 70, Ryūfan's Relatum from 69 onward, Sekine Nobuo's Face of Nothingness from 1969 and 70, and Koike Kazumasa's Kazushige's stones from 70. We can easily add more, actually. Uematsu Keiji's installation in 69, or performative photo of 73, Koshimizu Susumu's paper of 69, Kawaguchi Tatsuo's Stone and Light from 71, or Suga Kishio's stone floating over water from 71. However, here, let us focus on amplifying these diverse set by comparison on the slide, consisting of works by Smithson and Horikawa, along with Takamatsu, Koike, Kashihara, Rian, Sekine. In this set of works, we can see a few similar yet dissimilar characteristics. The most basic is the kind of stones used in them. Some use natural stones, Horikawa, Takamatsu, Kashihara, Koike, while some others use quarried stone rocks, Sekine and Ri, and stones Smithson used in the work, man-made. This is no trivial distinction, for the sources of their stones point to their relationship with nature. Horikawa, Takamatsu, and Koike took their stones from the Shinano River, Tama River, and Tenryu River, which constitute nature nearby for artists living in Niigata, Tokyo, Shizuoka, respectively. Kashihara took his stone from Shiokawa River in Murasaki, his wife's hometown, which thus qualifies as his nature nearby. Probably he went there for summer vacation or something. The idea of nature nearby is tied to the geological and meteorological characteristics of Japan. Lots of mountains with lots of rain produces lots of rivers with lots of stone dislodged from the mountains and transformed by their downstream travel before settling on the dry riverbeds. In many cities and towns of Japan, dry riverbeds are immensely accessible where stones are plentiful and thus available and affordable, meaning free. If you want a stone, you will go, the first place you go will be the river. With Smithson residing in New York City, it may not be nature nearby necessarily, but before his heroic grand art works such as Spiral Jetty, his home state, New Jersey, offered him landscape nearby, both man-made and nature-made, as the theoretical departure point of his non-site. In this work, his rocks are modern-day kind, asphalt and concrete wreckages from a torn-up road. The product of human labor, quarried stones are splintered between natural stones and man-made stones, representing an age-old intervention into nature. In his installation for the Venice in 1970, Sekine had to procure a stone from the immediate environment, that is, Italy, thus a quarried stone. In contrast, for the first iteration of his work he made in 69 in Hakone, he used a natural stone, although it's a pretty big one requiring more than the artist himself to pick up. Notably, Liu Fan, who initially used a quarried rock, subsequently used natural stones in his Relatum series. This change enhanced his conception of stone as a raw material state of iron contained in the rock, which is contrasted by its combination with steel plate, that is, the final industrialized state of iron. by mapping similar works. By mapping similar works in a spectrum of dissimilarity, we can associate them while contrasting them, and thus we regroup them. Another spectrum of comparison involves operation. The most experimental and unusual operation, both in terms of method and the idea behind it, is Horikawa's male art by sending stones, the idea directly inspired by the landing of Apollo 11 on the moon. Contrasting moon rocks and earth stones, he referenced the earthbound war in Vietnam, while placing stones completely outside the circulation of mechanisms of exhibition. In his non-sight, Smithson ingeniously brought the outdoors into the indoor context, calling his non-sight as indoor artworks that would engender a space of metaphoric significance between an actual sight and its counterpart non-sight. Kamatsu invited this process at his solo exhibition at Tokyo Gallery. He left a note to the gallery visitors to go out onto the streets of Ginza to find some of his stones onto which he had methodically inscribed the numerals between 0 and 1. Kashihara's tautologically examined stone is pure conceptualism, a chatty word unto itself. Here, the translation part, you can see the highlighted in green. This is a look as you see the with holes driven in and letters that is language embedded at the bottoms. That's exactly describing the work. In contrast, Koike went for an ontology of shock and awe, if you will, by bringing in numerous logs to a museum space, accentuating an unnatural situation by halving the stones cut into half. Probably best known outside Japan, Mono has stones which can be placed inside or outside the gallery in both the world differently, encouraging the viewer to have a phenomenological engagement with a new horizon of perception opened up around them. Their radicalism resided in metaphysics of an encounter with a world that was, quoting Heidegger by Liu Fan. A complex spectrum of spatiality, such as inside versus outside the gallery, metaphysical versus phenomenological versus material space, as well as a range of intellectual, theoretical, and political engagements, mark the present set of stoneworks and their operations. Can we dig deeper in comparing these works? One logical place to go is the context in which these operations took place, their respective artwork system, or, yet on another level, their respective cultural spheres. In a given locale, as much as the evolution of its cultural sphere, the development of its artwork system is highly localized. Multiple modernisms mean multiple stories of how each local system developed and functioned in its sociocultural milieu. These stories often diverge from those in the presumed center. All the more so, these local storylines are integral in studying the history of modernisms. Other vital yet often hidden storylines include internalized local logics and discourses and international interfaces. In certain cases, artist individual developments also constitute significant local storylines. This is where I'd like to introduce a methodological concept of narrative tangents and contact points for further amplification. Contact points represent a contact between the Eurocentric narrative and the local narrative, or among local narratives. A contact may be either connection or resonance. The former encompasses actual connections, such as interpersonal or informational encounters with counterparts, while the latter may be formulated post hoc among two or more similar works, where little such connection existed. Connections routinely constitute the basis of the transnational art history, but they must be supplemented to factor the contemporaneity of resonating practices worldwide. In the current comparison, Horikawa's relationship to Smithson is primarily resonance with some weak connections. That means knowledge of Horikawa's knowledge of Smithson through magazine reproductions that embodied an advanced state of international contemporaneity. Connected or resonated, contact points serve as entry points to the local history and open up the existing master narrative and paradigm, thereby creating intersecting tangents that reflect local logics and context. With each contact point, the rigid linearity of the familiar narrative is loosened, with hitherto invisible narrative tangents newly uncovered and bound together like a cluster by contemporaneity. This is a fertile ground. To explore. In my book, I have examined a range of narrative tangents centering on, among other things, the mainstreaming of the avant-garde, Zenhe, and Gendai Gijutsu. Some of them are relevant to this set of works, such as the use of photography. In this presentation, I would like to touch upon a narrative tangent I didn't go into in the book, that is specific to our set of comparison, the so-called tricky tendencies. It is an internalized local logic that more or less involved all of our Japanese stone artists. Intriguingly, Smithson also dabbled in optical trickery, though in a completely different local logic of New York art world, the responsive eye. Although this makes another fascinating resonance study, I won't go into the American tangent in detail today, focusing on the lesser known Japanese tangent. For the lack of convenient label, I call the Japanese tendency tricky art. Tricky art is characterized by the shared interest in visual trickery in two and three dimensional forms. It attracted attention from two critics, Nakahara Yusuke and Ishiko Junzo, who co-organized the exhibition Tricks and Vision, Stolen Eyes for Tokyo Gallery and Muramatsu Gallery in 68. I think these two critics of two different generations was their common critical interest centering on the issue of seeing, which had been articulated by Miyakawa Atsushi in reference to French theory and philosophy in the mid-decade. In practice, the indisputable leader of tricky art was Taka Matsujiro, a former Highlight Center member who developed his anti-art engagement with pointing to a broader exploration of ninshiki, cognition. Beginning in 65, he explored the gap between cognition and perception in his first post-Yomiuri Shizunajo series, Shadow, which practically turned him into the star of the mainstreaming avant-garde. It was followed by the study of perspective, which in a sense updated Onkawara's anxiously subjective interior of the early 50s into an impersonally objectified state of mind a decade later. And a sculpture from this series, perspective series, was included in Tricks and Vision. Versatile artist, Takamatsu pursued the riddle of cognition in conceptualism, monoha and photography in varying, in different degrees of trickiness. Not tricky, his stone and numera was a rare foray into institutional intervention that remained one of experiment. Another protagonist of tricky art was genshoku, meaning tactile hallucination, a short-lived group of young artists in Shizuoka active in 66 to 71. Supported by Ishiko Junzo, they pursued a surrealistic ontology with a distinct pop inflection in their study of problematic of visuality. A few members were included in Tricks and Vision. Koike was a genshoku member, excelled in object-based experiment, as his stone indicates. Kashihara Stone, too, participated in Tricks and Vision with his Silencer series. Despite its tricky appearance, his epistemological interest led him to question the property of painting. By the way, this is not a relief, this is a flat painting. His goal was to dismantle the institutional concepts such as art making and authorship through inventive and diligent procedural operations in contrast with Takamatsu's cerebral approach to sight. When Kashiwara applies his procedural step-by-step approach to the definition of such mundane things as book or a book, the result was analytical tautology. For Sekine Nobu and Lee Wupan, tricky art was a way station to Momoha. Both were strongly influenced by Takamatsu, with Lee also associated with Ishiko Junzo and Genshoku. A participant in tricky tricks and vision, Sekine continued to deploy his tricky intellect in his Momoha works, as exemplified by his landmark piece Mother Earth of 68. And his stone over steel column of 69 and 70, whose mirror surface column memorably dissolved into the natural environment around it through reflection, engendering a visual trickery that the stone is floating in the air. The youngest in this set, Horikawa, began his career under the influence of Genshoku's ontology, as evident in his gigantic shining necktie. Yeah, the jacket next to it is the life size, so you can see how gigantic this necktie made of stainless steel is. Except that this kind of ontology was an utter creative dead end for him. He broke the impasse by turning to his predecessors for inspiration. Male art by Onkawara, Matsuzawa Yutaka, and Genshoku, as well as Takamatsu's stone. His inspired interpoetic exploration led to male art by sending stones, with his own idea of earth stones as opposed to moon rocks, decisively departing from tricky art for conceptualism. When we think of world art history, it sometimes feels bewildering to look into the locally specific in great detail, such as the excellence of tricky art. Another question is, why should such detail matter in a bigger global picture? Short as it may be, the narrative tangent of tricky art is complex with its own cluster of sub-tangents. Seen from the outside, it may look an anomaly, but it did set the stage for the stone-based works of the late 60s, as well as Momoha, just as, say, Greenberg's formalist criticism, which exerted little influence over Japanese artists, but was partly and then profoundly responsible for the rise of Smithson and his fellow post-minimalists in New York. Taken together, they made a cluster of narrative tangents generated by these forms and animate a global narrative. What is fascinating with 60s art is that despite all these local differences, contemporaneity more often than not bind together practices an ocean apart in a resonating overarching challenge. In this case, to fundamentally call into question the institution of art as codified in modernism. In other words, in the 60s, modernisms matured in varying degrees, with an increasing number of local times beginning to synchronize, and artists in different locales moving in one or more shared directions simultaneously. This constitutes another higher level of similarity and regrouping. It is a structural similarity because it concerns the very fundamental premise of modernism. This means that we then have to magnify our comparative strategy to see similar yet dissimilar characters. Herein, we decenter, amplify, and regroup in two levels of similar. While the first level of similar offers contact entrance point to the local, the second level of similar offers a collection of larger frameworks that characterize the 60s phase of modernism. After gaining this macro view, we may diversify the first level of similarity by investigating a broader time frame and geographical scope that encompass other examples in the Norwich exhibition, along with such earlier examples as Budai member Motonaga Sadamasa's whimsical storm, or the Korean Lee Sontag's sometimes tricky approach. Or we can also go back to individual works to evaluate their significances in our context. There still remains much to do in microhistory too. In conclusion, the methodology of looking at similar in this presentation is inherently group-oriented, in that rather than looking at individual works as a starting point, we begin with comparables. Then, should we develop a canon of sort, definitely useful pedagogy and museum display are necessary for a general shape of history. What we need is not so much canonical works, as opposed to canonical comparisons, culled from various regions. Euro-American works may remain important, but they will be put through the same process of decentering, amplifying, and regrouping. The second level of similar may well generate decentered characters of modernism, which will help us see multiple modernisms in a spectrum. For modernism as such is a construct that was never monolithic in time or space, constantly evolving over time in many places. Thank you.